This is a code walkthrough for the example file PersonPhase9.java. This snapshot represents the next set of changes we're making to this growing person class, and these changes involve data safety in our class. Rather than demonstrate these changes as I've done before, and which is subject to a little bit of error and fumble fingeredness, I'd like to just walk through these changes and show you what we've added as the next set of refinements. So let's scroll down here a little bit to the mutators in our file, specifically the ones for height and weight. And what we've added here is what I've referred to as mutator data checking. Simply the idea that we want to be able to check an input value and make sure that it is a valid value that perhaps meets some specified data parameters. For example, for our height, we're going to use an if-else selection structure to check that this height is within a certain range, greater than a minimum height, less than a maximum height. If that's the case, we'll make the change to the instance variable as we've done before. But if it's not, we'll reject this change, we'll leave it at whatever value it's set to right now, and we'll flag the user in some way. Same kind of thing for the weight. We want to make sure that the input weight is within a certain range from min weight to maximum weight. If it is, we'll change our instance variable to this value. If not, we'll leave the weight at whatever value it's set to right now, and we'll flag the user. We can also do a similar kind of thing for the biological gender. Let's say we want to make sure that the value that we set our instance variable to is only one of two possible values in uppercase. We take this input char, we turn it into uppercase, and then in this compound condition, we're checking that it's either equal to this value or this value. If that's the case, we'll update our instance variable with the uppercase equivalent of whatever was input. If that's not the case, we'll leave the current setting alone and we'll flag the user. By making these kind of changes, we can ensure data validity and we can enforce that our instance variables are always proper and within certain specified ranges. Speaking of those specified ranges, up here at the top of the file, notice that we've added a couple of constants, and these are global to the file. They're not really true instance variables in the sense that the outside world is never going to know about these, but these are global settings that we can use private to our class, and we can collect up all these settings in one place. For example, we want to enforce that our height is always going to be from 0 to 3 meters, and our weight is going to be from 0 to 400 kilograms. Now, having these mutator data checks in place doesn't do us any good if we don't use these exclusively. So turning our attention next to the constructors, notice that the default constructor is unchanged. We're setting up some sensible defaults that are at designer's discretion. But for the full constructor and the overloaded constructor, now instead of simply setting the instance variables to these values, we're going to first run them through these mutators. We don't want the user to be able to set up a full constructor person with invalid values for height or weight, for example. So if we use the mutators exclusively in the constructors, as we're doing here, we can enforce proper data at the point of creation. Same thing here for the overloaded constructor. Now we're using the mutators to set the first and last name. Now when we do this kind of thing, one thing we have to do is make sure that we've got some default values to fall back upon. If the values we're trying to set our instance variables to are improper in some way, we need some values to fall back upon for our instance variables. And then, so what we'll do as the first executable statement is we'll add the statement this in both places, which is simply a call to the default constructor, so it'll pull in sensible defaults for all the values, such that if any of these mutator data checks fails, we still have some values that we can fall back upon. Finally, on to the subject of safely transferring object data into our class. So for that, let's scroll down to the accessor and mutator for the birth date. And notice that before, we were simply doing something like this. For the mutator, we were simply doing this.birthDate equals birthDate, or for the accessor, simply returning the birthDate. As we've seen in the lecture materials, this is not a safe way to transfer data into or out of instance variables, which themselves may be objects. So what we'll do instead is we'll do a transfer of data. So for example, in the mutator, if the outside client is passing in a birth date like this, we'll simply extract the month from that birth date and then use the mutator for our instance variable to transfer these values field by field into the instance variable. Okay, so this side here represents the input object. This side here represents the instance variable. So we're transferring the data over integer by integer to the instance variable. And in this way, the outside world doesn't have any direct connection or access to our instance variable. And so now it's properly kept private. In a similar fashion, for accessors, we don't simply want to return the instance variable itself because we're providing an object reference directly into our class by doing that. So what we do instead is we take our instance variable and retrieve our month, day, and year from it, and we set it to this temporary junk object that we set up, and we're transferring the instance variable data into that scratch copy and then returning a copy of the birth date instance variable to the caller. Again, by doing this, we're not giving up any outside access to our instance variable object. So finally, how do we go about testing all these changes? Well, let's go down to the main method and look at what we've added here in the way of test code. So for example here, we're testing all of the individual mutators with data checking by trying to run impermissible values through them. And we're also trying to set up a new person with the same impermissible values for gender, height, and weight. So what we can do, as always, is we need to save this to person. So we're going to save this to person.java so that we can actually run it. And we'll save over the version we have. And we'll compile this, and what we will do is we'll set a breakpoint right here, and we'll run this with a debugger, and we have to go through some previous test code to get to that. So I'll just kind of blast my way through this. And now we're here. So we're trying to set the gender to an impermissible value. But we can't. It's just going to flag us and leave the value alone. Similarly, we can't set the height to 5 meters. We can't set the weight to 1,000 kilograms. And we can't set up a person who's 5 meters tall and 1,000 kilograms. So we should get 3 error messages from trying to set up this person, as we do right here. And so if we print our object out, we see that we have the specified values for certain fields. But for the gender, height, and weight, we're going to fall back to the default values of a default person. As far as the safe data transfer goes, we'll set up a new person with default values. We'll set up a CS12 date, and we'll update the birth date using that CS12 date. And we'll print it out. And then what we'll do is we'll set this date external to our object, like so. It's now 2/2/2002, and what we want to see is that these changes did not make their way into the object that we created. So if we print out that object, we see that even though we updated its birth date with this object, and then later updated that object, these changes didn't make their way into our person, which is exactly as we would expect. So this is how we implement mutator data checking and safe transfer of data into and out of objects for our new person class.